My name is Deanna Peters, and I'm been a professional dance artist for the past 13 years. I'm originally from Saskatoon. I made my way here via Edmonton, where I went to college in dance, and then I graduated with a degree from SFU. I'm a choreographer, a performer, a teacher, and a producer, and I create for the stage, the web, screen, site-specific, and beyond. I'm also a communications professional, and I'll be talking with you guys a little bit during the lunch break about CADA and CDA. But I joined my two careers together, reimagining my movement practice through other media. And I'm gonna pass the microphone on to the rest of the panel, and they're gonna introduce themselves.
Why did I sit in this chair? Hi, my name is Heather Laura Gray. I have been working in this industry for a while. I started training in ballet school at L'École Supérieure de Danse du Québec, and ended up at the Go Ballet later on, and then found my way into loving, and I also did a lot of other training in tap, many other disciplines, jazz, hip-hop, all that stuff. And I found myself in the musical theater scene of Toronto because I really wanted to get paid to do dance. And so I started singing and worked my butt off with that, and just then decided I wanted to be an actor. So then I decided I had a little bit of career ADHD. I love many different vehicles to communicate, and so that was kind of my way into really understanding myself through acting and understanding how to truly be an alive and awake performer, no matter what I was doing. And then I found my way back into contemporary into dance, and then contemporary, fully immersed myself in that, started working here locally. I came back from Toronto, and from then on, I produced my own work, and am now currently focusing on choreography. I've danced for other companies, and I just love dance. Just not gonna lie, like, I'm obsessed. And I look forward to creating more. I work commercially on sets. I choreograph for TV and film, and I love it all. So I instantly love you. Okay, good.
We have a mic. I'm Shannon Teat, born and raised here in Vancouver. I was a dancer my whole life, since I was three. I started traveling as soon as I was allowed to, and any opportunities that came that allowed me to travel and perform, I took them. I just was obsessed with the travel bug and going everywhere I could that dance would take me. And I did that for a long time on cruise ships and touring shows. I fell in love on a cruise ship. And I slowly started getting drawn more and more to the other side of performing. I was still loving performing, but I was always getting opportunities to be on audition panels or help coordinate auditions or help with castings or direct things that were going on. So I kept getting drawn that way, and I couldn't figure out why, and it just kept happening. Eventually I realized how much I was really loving it. And my latest transition now is I'm an agent at DaCosta Talent Management. So I'm and we represent Heather. I represent singers, dancers, actors, and I have this entirely new love for the industry and not creating work, but bridging the gap between the work and performers and breaking down barriers for performers and choreographers. And I just have this entirely new love for the industry from the other side now, which is really exciting and really fun, and still being able to bring my performing background to what I do now. So that's what I do.
My name's Josh. I'm originally from Alberta. I moved out to Vancouver when I was 18, and worked in hip-hop, commercial dance, and then eventually shifted into contemporary dance, and eventually founded a collective called 605 Collective. And so now, after, I guess, 10 years of that, it's now a full company, and so I'm the co-artistic director of Company 605. And we create new contemporary dance works, and we tour those works nationally and internationally, and we are basically just an arts organization that tries to do a lot of things around dance, and we have different components of our programs that we do, and so we are very much on the public subsidized side of the dance sector. And from there, I get to dance and collaborate with other companies and other artists, and we develop our own projects, and that's basically it.
Hi guys, my name's Alpha. I'm originally from Winnipeg, and I moved out to Vancouver when I was 19 to study at the Go Ballet. And my first job ever was in Singapore. So I didn't know where it was in the world exactly. And I said, Mom, I'm moving to Singapore. I got my first job. And then I was like, that's kind of far from home. So a couple years later, I ended up joining Alberta Ballet. And through dancing, I continued playing piano on the side. And that's when I loved learning how to coach. Especially young students in Nutcracker, coaching them on their best potential, coaching them on who they get to be when they go on stage and how they get to make the audience feel and what they feel like after that show, that buzz, that energy, that, oh my God, we just did another show, like, wow. And so through that, I thought I'd be a French school teacher because I studied French. So I left ballet and I went to SFU and studied French. And I taught French, I taught English in France, and realized, don't want to be a French school teacher. Now what do I do? So throughout this whole time, to pay for university, I worked at Lululemon. And that's when I learned about vision goals, about who do you want to be in 10 years, and how do you trickle that back to start setting small goals that are not really terrifying, day after day, week after week, year after year. And through the coaching and love of that, I've gotten a job at Lululemon, coaching store managers, regional managers, area directors, on people and on how to elevate your people every day through all the different retail initiatives. So I'm one of the few in this panel that actually I don't perform anymore. I still play piano at Harvard Dance Center, so I still stay connected to the community. I still see Ballet BC shows, Alberta Ballet shows, anyone that comes in the city. And I'm really excited to see all your faces light up. Thanks.
So, yeah, I work for Lululemon as well, and I worked at head office and through people and recruiting, and that's how I know you. Yeah.
The dance community is a very small world.
Yeah. I know, me too.
And that's going to take us to the next question. I thought it would be good to tell you guys about our first gig. And I'll tell you, my very first gig was with Paul-André Fautier. He's a Montreal-based choreographer, and he was making a dance film with Daniel Conrad and Crystal Pite. And that was the first time I was hired. I was still in university. And the way I got that job was that I used to attend Mary Louise Albert's classes at Harbor Dance Center. I just took everybody's class. So I would say my first four gigs were from people that I attended their drop-in classes at Harbor Dance and CADA classes and different things that exist, which we can talk about later. And she put my name forward. And so I was dancing with Azure Barton, Cherise Barton, Jay Gower Taylor, John Ottman, people who were teaching me in university. And later I went on to work with Mary Louise at the Huspa Festival. So my connection through people getting to know me as a dancer, first and foremost, was what really got me into make sense into my first gig. So I'm going to ask the panel about their first gig and specifically to give us anecdotes on how they got it.
Awesome. Well, I started young in acting, so I'm going to kind of avoid that as my first gigs. But when I moved to Toronto and I was auditioning countless times in the regular auditioning circuit for musical theater. So I'd say a good 50 total fails, like realizing like, how does this audition process work? How do people see me? So for example, I had short hair and that just really didn't work for anybody. I was just too cool. And I was auditioning for like the love interest in whatever musical, right? It just didn't work. So I started like growing my hair and then it realized that that really worked well. And then I got my first gig was a Charlottetown musical theater gig. It was like a new musical. It's called Gabrielle and Evangeline. No one's heard of it? Oh, okay. So anyways, so excited. I was working at Starbucks. I was like, peace out, guys. And they're like, yeah, well, you were a great worker. We'll welcome you back. So that's a really good thing to know. Like, if you're working somewhere and you're a good worker, they'll usually bring you back. You can take a sabbatical. So I was core. And I was the chorus, and I was the lead understudy. So for me, I had just really started singing, and that was a huge thing for me. My director was drunk pretty much all the time. Like, I'm not gonna lie, like, whoa, profusely drunk. And I didn't understand what was going on, because for me, I've been told my entire life that, like, be professional, be on your best behavior. So just a FYI, like, you're gonna encounter some very interesting people along the way. The arts, as you know, is not along the regular path. So I learned so much from these people who were struggling to do their art. And you know, me being really wide-eyed and new to it, I just soaked it all in and had the best time in PEI. That's a wrap on me. There you go.
My first gig, I would say, was probably dancing at the Peony when I was 15. Has anybody worked at the Peony in any of the shows there? Yeah. It was back when it was just the parades, and I was really young, and I auditioned, and it was my first time being in a job where I was being paid, and I was expected to be there every day and do my thing, and I remember feeling really, really young. I remember I was all of a sudden doing a job with people that I really looked up to, teachers that had instructed me, people whose careers I admired, and all of a sudden I'm doing a job with them. So I remember being really aware of how they show up for work, kind of the same thing, like I was always expected to show up to your job, be professional, and you'll see the different types of people that either are doing that, aren't doing that, and I remember just wanting to be a sponge and suck it all in and see how people are performing in a professional job. So I just remember, yeah, being really excited to work with people I looked up to at the P&E.
mine's kind of cliche. My first gig was working on a cruise ship. And I had auditioned numerous times. I was working at a gas station. And I had auditioned numerous companies, never got a call back. And I think I had just about given up. Like, it was really at that place. I'm living in Alberta, in a small town in Alberta. Only male dancer around, for sure. And like, pretty much at that point, all my friends had just graduated, and they had all my friends went off to college or university. And I'm sitting there at a gas station in Camrose, Alberta. And had never gotten a call back or anything like that. But then eventually what had happened is, by chance, some guy they had hired had bailed out, and I was like next on the list. And so I ended up getting a call in the middle of the winter and says, we need you in a week to come down to Miami or wherever we were. And so that was my way out of Alberta. And so from doing that first gig, I managed to save enough money so that I could move here, and that was it.
My first gig was in Singapore. I remember rehearsing so many variations so many times and trying to videotape it just the right angle. You didn't turn out your foot, your pirouette was off, and the number of times you have to perfect that video, because that's the one chance at that time on VHS, sending those tapes out that you got to have a director or anybody look at your work. I was very fortunate that I was a short girl. and they happened to need a short girl in Singapore, and they needed someone with my level of experience, which was zero. And I also was fortunate that Mr. and Mrs. Goh really took me under their wing and said, you're old, like you're 19 and you're old to start your very professional training. And if you work really hard, we will do everything we can to get you to where you want to be. But there's no guarantee, as you know, there's no guarantee that you will make it. You have some good facility and some really bad habits. So it was that same feeling of how do you be your very best every day and take that to your first job, where not everyone will have the exact same outlook as you, but how do you stay true to yourself and say, even though you got your first job, does that mean you made it? Does that mean that's it, I got a job, I'm good, I'm set? Or does it mean you keep trying and make yourself better every day? And I think that was the hardest part. When you got your first job, you're like, okay, I got it, I made it. I still have to work really hard every day. Even though there may be some people in companies that may not, but you have to choose that for yourself. Thank you.
So just to recap a little bit, because it seems like there's a few themes that have come up, but also a few differences in terms of dance forms. So you know, Heather's example is a lot of experience is not it's not just positive experience. When you're going into processes, often you're learning maybe what you don't want to do or how you don't want to be. So another theme that I saw come up, or I heard come up, was the theme of migration. So the commitment of everybody on this panel to immerse themselves where dance, where professional dance was happening, and then the necessity to do that. So that could be a really big move, but that's a move that many of us had to do for our career. Myself coming from Saskatoon, it was very similar to Josh. I couldn't do what I wanted to do where I currently was. So I had to seek out the community that I wanted to be a part of. And lastly, auditions. So this auditions has come up a few times. For example, my first dance gig, there was not an audition for that gig. And that would be more close to my experience in contemporary dance. And I can't speak a lot to auditions, but it sounds to me that there are some things you can control about how you're perceived. Heather with her hair, you know, she can change her hair. But Alpha with being short or tall, there's things that you can't control. And so Alpha's asking, how do you stay true to yourself? And how do you worry about and concern yourself with the things that you can change and the things that you can control? And I also appreciated this concept of like, okay, you have your first gig, now what's next? So for me, as I was having my first gig and going to university, I was also seeking out my second gig at the same time. And that's something I've learned along the way. You put in a grant and then you forget about it and you start working on the next thing. And you don't just sit around and wait for that grant or that application to come through. Yeah, so it's this constant overlap. So that's one of the things that changed in me when I started to self-identify as a professional as opposed to a student or, you know, a dancer. So I'm going to pass the mic around. It doesn't have to go in order, but I'd like to hear a bit about what changed in you, in your practice, in your mindset, when you self-identified as a professional artist.
I think just talking about the dance community being quite small, I think that moment of switching to deciding, okay, yes, I'm a professional dance artist, is sort of your citizenship into that community. I think it's about really just feeling connected to all the people who are all working at the same thing. I mean, we're all working on different things, but we're all kind of with the same intention. And I think recognizing how at least in my experience, it's really not a competition. Even auditions aren't a competition. It's really just about all of us wanting to somehow have this be a job that can exist, a career that can exist. And being part of that community just means opening up all these other doors. And I think that for me, especially once considering myself a professional dance artist, there's sort of a networking that instantly happens where one thing just leads to the next thing, leads to the next thing. And it's just, there's always these cross connections between people. Like there's so few people that I haven't somehow come across in Vancouver in some way or another professionally, who are professional dance artists. And so I think there's just sort of a pride and overarching goal that happens when there's people who are working together and just feeling how close we actually are.
It took me a really long time to connect to that. I always felt like an outsider. I think it came from going to ballet school and being so hardcore in ballet and realized that I didn't have the facility. I was so stubborn. I was like, I'm gonna be a ballet dancer. And I had like no facility to do that. And I hung on to it for a really long time because I didn't want to fail. So I always felt like an outsider until I decided, and I think that's, I really like what he said about the pride that you feel when you're like, no, I like, this is what I love doing and I want to be so good at it that people want to pay money to see it, right? Or that I feel that I am optimizing my ability and my artistry and my physicality and doing it to the utmost if this is my choice in my life. And I think I had to kind of surrender to it because it just kept coming back. I was like, I'm gonna be an actor now. I'm just gonna avoid that. And then I was like, man, I'm dreaming about dance, and I just want to be in it. And I just remember the day when Amber Funk Barton was like, hey, do you want to be in my company? And I was like, hold up, everything stop. Yes, everything I was doing, I just didn't care about anymore. And I realized, I was like, you just got to let go and recognize that you are a dance artist, but that's a choice that you need to make. And then look at, what do I need to do then to be the best I possibly can for me? And then great, if people want to pay for it. So I didn't want that to come across as like, people got to pay money, you got to be amazing, and you got to do flips. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying like, look at everything about this art form and what is part of it to be able, it's not just dancing. Cool.
Something else, I was thinking a lot of things both of you said, but then something else that really clicked with me is your reputation as you network within a community that can be really small. It feels really big, but then it can be really small. And I started to realize really young that I wanted people to want to work with me, and not just because I was the best person in the room or I wasn't the best person in the room with my whatever it is that they're looking for. I wanted to have a really good reputation that I work hard, I show up, I'm nice to work with, I'm reliable. Those things became really important to me at a young age, and it has really helped me quite a bit. I know that all the jobs that I've done, that people enjoy working with me, and that I don't say that lightly. It really mattered to me and I worked hard at it. So I was happy that I realized that at a young age, and I think that's really, really important to be good to work with. Yeah.
I'm going to piggyback on that because being reliable is so important. If you think of when you're dancing and you're a corps de ballet when you first join a ballet company, like, yes, you want to stand out as being really hardworking, like really on top of it, but you also don't want to stand out so much that they're like, you're in the core, like don't try and move around so much, don't wave your arms higher, right? So there's a certain amount of understanding where you stand in any company or any group you join, and to know that you are the one who drives your worth. So it's not about how much money you make, it's not about whether you're the principal in this role, whether you're singled out in another role. Like, every single role is so important in any performance. And it's to understand that value in yourself. Yeah.
Yeah, so I think it's interesting that what's coming up a lot is a sense of responsibility. So what came with self, I use that word very thoughtfully, self-identifying. That with that, people have taken on a sense of responsibility, and that there's particular values that they have set around their career. So just to give an idea of what directions your career has moved in, I want to, and just to mention that this means like outside of dance as well, so it could be both, but just to give us an example of what a day is like for you professionally. So you don't have to tell us what you had for breakfast or whatever, but you know, professionally, what is a well-rounded day for you? So for example, for me, training is still a huge part of my practice. I set aside time every day for training. For me, that's a very broad, from doing professional development projects where I'm being mentored one-on-one to attending classes that are open for professional dance artists at EDAM Dance, at the Dance Center here for Working Class, at Harbor Dance Center workshops that come. So training for me is very important, but also I have a strong value around creating dialogue around dance and talking about it whenever I can. And for me, that means talking about it face to face. And when people ask me what I do, I'm not like, oh, I'm a professional dancer. Like, you know, I've thought about how I want to speak about myself and to represent my career and my community. But I think of other ways of doing that as well. So online, through a website, through social media. If you look at social media feeds, there's not a lot of people talking about their posture or talking about their physical embodiment. You know, and as a dance artist, I see, oh, I have this knowledge, and this is a way for me to share. I can share my knowledge. How can I share my knowledge?
Oh, sure. So my life has changed now as an agent rather than performing as much as I was. Our usual day now is, I'm kind of a mobile business. I have my laptop here right now, and it's managing the work as it comes in for our clients, whether it be commercials, film, TV, those types of things, and deciding who's right for what projects and putting things forward and connecting. And then a lot of our days are also knowing what's going on in the community, social media, seeing shows as much as we can. We get out to as many things as we can, one, to support our clients, and two, so that we know what's going on and who's doing what, because that's really important. And then touching in with as many clients as we can. We try to hold meetings, set out new goals and plans for our clients, because everybody's path is going to be so different. There's not one way to make it in this industry. And something that you actually said at a panel we were on before, which I think is so important, is remembering that there is a path and room for everyone. Whatever it is that makes sense for you is what you should be doing, and that can sound cliche, but there is space for everyone, and you don't have to do it exactly the way, say you really look up to Josh, doesn't mean you have to do it exactly how he did it, or Heather, or whoever, just figuring that out. So we try to mentor our clients with that as much as we possibly can and help them find out what their path is and how we can support them and create those opportunities for them. So, yeah.
Day in the life. So boring. No, it's it really just depends. When you're running a company, you're dealing with projects that might be 2.5 years down the road, that you're just kind of envisioning, or that you're finding the funds to make happen, or you're trying to contract the dancers, or scheduling is a nightmare. So, you know, my mornings basically consist of meetings and emailing and getting the right information to the right people, and to just make sure that everyone knows what's going on at all times, and that we've got the plan is still moving ahead as it's supposed to. Typically, we work 6 hours a day in the studio. We show up, hour warm up, or kind of share class or something like that, and then we basically are creating a new work for the next 5 hours every 5 or 6 days a week. And then nighttime is lately devoted to a lot of grant writing, and it's just about a lot of writing. Like, in general, my life feels like almost half writing, which is still actually part of, for me, my creative process, because I feel like through having to articulate what it is I'm trying to make or what it is I'm trying to do through words, through getting it out on paper, And then looking at it and kind of being like, well, that's not actually what I want to be doing. I want to change that. And so there's a whole process that's just involved in creating writing a grant application where you have to really define what it is that you're after and really decide why it is that it's important to you and maybe to other people who might want to see the work. There's a lot of my evenings that are spent just kind of planning and writing and budgeting and thinking about what would make this project great. And that's basically a day in life.
I'm going to piggyback on that one again because mine is parallel except not in dance. Mine's in an office. So Josh talked a lot about project work and that's mostly what I do. And I think the planning is probably the hardest part is like, as I spoke about before, setting what that vision of what does your project look like, and like why is it important? Why do you care about it? And why do you want other people to care about it? And then you start thinking, okay, who are the different people that need to know about this project? Who are the different people that I need help with, to whether it's sets, whether it's lighting, whether it's grants, like getting all those people aligned to understand like what is this big cool thing that I want you to be part of? And then again, lots of meetings across the country. So understanding the different time zones and getting your calendar in place. I think as a dancer, I would have my schedule like Monday, you know, class starts at 9 o'clock. Okay, so make sure I'm there by 8:15 to start warming up and like make sure I'm ready for class. And then it's like, okay, rehearsal 10 to 12, 20 minute lunch break, and then I have rehearsals till 5. You know, it's pretty standard like that every day. And it's learning how to be agile, being like, oh, that rehearsal's canceled. Okay, I have to be in this other building. It's 20 minutes walk. How do I get there? When do I have time to eat? Do you guys ever schedule time to eat in your day? It's something I had to learn to do because I was like, oh, I have back-to-back meetings for 8 hours. How do you take care of your body while you're also pursuing something you love? So that's also what's challenging is making the time for you and so that you can be best in the world at what you love doing.
I just have to comment on that. I recently, I'm just working on a new 20-minute piece plug. It's Sunday at 2 p.m. at Performance Works, if you want to come. It's with Oro Collective. So I had a dancer in the morning. We've been doing morning rehearsals on one day a week. And all of a sudden, he was like, I'm starting to see black. And I'm like, whoa, dude, like, you're about to faint. Like, sit down. I'm like, are you okay? Did you eat? He's like, yeah, I've been doing this, like, new fast thing for, like, 12 hours. And I'm like, you're lifting people. And so I know sometimes it's like you want to be in the best shape possible or, you know, you want to look good or whatever. But just take into account, like, starving yourself does not work as a dancer. It's counterintuitive for the body. Your adrenal glands start overproducing adrenaline, and then your body starts to pull as much blood as possible to the areas that it needs, and then you have no blood in your brain. There you go. Okay, so that's, don't do that. Okay, good, awesome. A day in the life is really interesting. I find working in the commercial world as well as the company world is really conflicting because one is like, hey, we need you tomorrow to choreograph the single and set, and you drop everything in your life to make sure that you're gonna do the best job possible for that. And then contemporary company life is, yeah, yearly, in 3 months, you're gonna do this 3-month contract with this company. So it's lovely, but they do conflict. It's really especially hard with an agent, because you have to say like, I'm not gonna be around for this period of time. They can't make money off of you, or with you, I should say. That sounded really brutal. Wow. Let's reverse that, delete. But you know what I mean? I mean that in the best of way, in that you can't work together with someone if you're collaborating to make money together. So it is a little, you gotta know when you're like, okay, I really need to do this project with the company, and I have to say no to commercial world, because that's the worst thing, to be like, in like week 4 of rehearsal, be like, hey guys, I'm gonna peace out and go do this commercial for Gillette. See ya. No one's gonna like you, and you're breaking your contract. So you have to be really aware of what you're communicating to the infrastructure of people that are around you that are helping you get work. That's really, really important. A day in the life, really quickly, yeah. Get up early, write emails, go to class, train, read read. I love learning more about what I don't know, because you don't know what you don't know until you know, right? So, is that biggie? Yeah, okay. So yeah, just read and know what's going on in the world. Know, I remember actually, is it Myrna? Yeah, she, I went to a grant writing thing with her a long time ago, and she said, you need to know what's happening in this world to be able to comment on it in your artistry, or just know in general, because it's going to influence how you connect with your audience, because your audience is connected to this world and they're reading and they're knowing what's going on. So sometimes we get so immersed in dance that you actually isolate yourself, you actually disconnect yourself from humanity. And that's something I really focus on. Thanks.
So dance professionals are also communications professionals. They're writers, they're facilitators, they're administrators, managers, and also health professionals. So that's a, how do you get these skills? How do you identify what skills you need and how do you go about getting them? So now we're talking about resources for dance professionals. And I've been a member of the Dancer Transition Resource Center since 2005. So that's 11 years. And I've used their skills training grants to, I had an interest in graphic design. I was already practicing graphic design, but I wanted to get some more chops. So I went to Emily Carr and I did some Photoshop and different courses in 2D design. And I also learned HTML programming through an artist through Vivo. And because, you know, as an artist, I wanted to do an alternative sort of training. I'm used to, you know, doing this quite obscure sort of training that nobody knows anything about. And so the DTRC, through their programming, I was able to not have to go to an institution to learn. I was able to learn from another artist. And that was really important to me. So the freedom to be able to have funds to go, and this was paid for. I didn't pay a cent for any of that training because the DTRC covered it. So just to have that freedom and those funds, so just to understand that transition is constantly happening. Yeah. So I'm going to ask the panelists really quickly, in like 30 seconds each, to talk about a resource that was that really helped them.
Cool. I'm going to definitely say DTRC. Same thing. I needed counseling. I needed help. And it was there. You get 12. You have different counselors that you can choose from. It could be financial. It could be emotional. It could be career. So I was able to use those at no cost. And I just put in my grant for Pilates certification. I've started my certification. And I'm hoping that I will get the grant.
My biggest resource was people. People that I was working with, people that I looked up to, teachers, coaches, any type, anybody in the industry. I just wanted to talk to them, and I wanted to know what they were doing, how they got there, what their path was, what helped them. I just loved talking to people and hearing how they were doing it, and that was my main one.
Yeah, I think that's great. The people, you'd be surprised how many people will give you advice and help in this community. It's crazy how much I've learned from people by just asking them. But I'd also say just like the government of Canada, who all fund all of these things like the DTRC. They have so many grants and opportunities for you to receive money to do what it is that you want to do, and you should really take advantage of that.
So a combination of people and the DTRC, I fractured my foot when I was dancing with Alberta Ballet, and it was that time that I called the DTRC crying, saying, I don't know what I'm gonna do, I may never dance again. And they supported me in getting a grant so I could start studying my first business course, which was back in 2009. And little did I know at that time, now I'm actually working in business, but it's constantly learning and asking questions and being curious to what other people do in other industries, in your own industry, and especially what Josh said, how did they get there?
I'm gonna also mention Canadian Alliance of Dance Artists, West chapter specifically out here. I've been a member of CADA West since 2003, and primarily their training subsidy program. If you're an emerging or professional member, you can get up to $500 subsidy per year to support you in your training, which could be a huge financial burden for you. So the memberships, are about $75 a year, and it's a really good investment to get that subsidy. They have some new programs, the studio subsidy program, if you want to start initiating training programs. And also, they have a contract template for hiring various different artists, and they have fees and rates standards. So just to sort of get to know those standards, Google. So like, if you don't know any, like, if what's DTRC, what's Google it. That's a really good resource. Like, if you hear a name you don't know, I go home, I'm like, who's that? You know, this morning we got to meet Deep. I went and looked him up on Twitter, and now we're connected, right? So if you don't know something, Google it. And that's a very good resource. So for the next 5 to 10 minutes, we're gonna be your Google, your search engine. So as much as we can. So I'm gonna open the floor up for any questions. So just take 10 seconds, think about something, a burning desire, and let's just come out with it. Yeah, let's see if we can not hesitate too much. I'd rather have three people asking a question at the same time than nobody asking a question at all. So 5, 4. Okay. Yeah, there we go.
I think more specifically, like Josh, Heather, and Deanna, you guys are talking about applying for grants.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering, how do you, your living expenses, are you actually paying like for your life through that, or like how else are you making money when you're not, if you're not like dancing for a company or whatever, you're trying to make your own work, how else are you making money if it's not just grants?
Very good question. It kind of goes back to what I said earlier. I mean, I'm an independent artist, so I'm not supported through operating funding, so I've taken on the responsibility of doing my own admin, and financially, that means that I can't depend on grants to for my sustenance, my subsistence. Yeah, they're to fund my creative projects. So I've organized. I often say this. I teach a lot at Modus. I'm like, how are you organizing your life? Like, are you organizing your life so you can do class? I know it's difficult, but it's possible. So it's about organizing your life so that when I ask you, hey, how come I didn't see you at class for last year? You're not telling me, oh, it's because of my job. And if that is really your goal, right? So sometimes we'll say one thing and then we'll kind of make it impossible for us to do that. So for myself, I diversify my income between self-employed income. So that includes grants and funding. And yes, pay yourself in your grants. And don't apply for the minimum rate. Apply for, the minimum rate is set as a minimum. So most likely when you apply for a grant, you're not gonna get all your funding. And so you don't wanna apply at the minimum rate and then be paying people below that rate. So, ask for what you need and what you want. So I diversify my income between self-employed income and employment income. So for example, I work at Cata West and I get paid monthly. I work at Dance International Magazine, I get paid monthly. I set up my taxes so I take more tax off of my employment income so that at the end of the year, I don't get nailed with all my self-employed tax to pay. So I'm constantly banking into those programs so that I'm not having to pay out $4,000 or whatever at the end of the year.
Oh yeah, I teach, so I really enjoy it. It's helped me in my process as well. I love communicating with people, and at first it was like, oh yeah, I'll use this to fund my life, and then it was like, oh wow, this is actually an amazing thing for me. So, but it's a balance. I don't know if any, I'm sure a lot of you are teachers. You can get exhausted and burnt out very quickly. So I like the balance of many things. I would say diversify your profile and how you earn income.
When we talk about grants, there's literally hundreds of different types of grants, and I think you reach a point where, I mean, we've been going for 10 years, so there's a consistency there where all my income comes from the company, and that's how I support myself. And yeah, of course, you pay yourself a fee. You're an artist. You should be paid money, and that money is your income, and that's inside of the grant funding. And I think that there's maybe a lot of misconceptions about what grants are and what they aren't. And I just want to clarify that a grant is a support to help assist something that you're already doing. So when I receive a grant, it's not just like free money, here you go, make something with that. It's like, well, we have a project, so we've compiled money from the BC Arts Council, the Canada Council, the City of Vancouver, the Hammer Foundation, the Kerner Foundation, the revenue from ticket sales, the sponsorship that you managed to get in, the in-kind donations from so-and-so who managed to give you free projector or something like that for your weekend. But it's all kind of compiled in there, so no one's expecting you to make something amazing with a small amount of money. They're expecting you to be reaching out into the community for all the things that are available to you. And through that, with all of those things combined, then you start to have the consistency to be able to build a repertoire of work or an audience that is going to return to your next show. Or there's lots of these sort of tools that are there for us to combine, and that's it's for me. I'm definitely lucky, but there's a rate where it starts to compile in a way where you actually have a job that pays you enough money to sustain yourself.
Thank you.
And FYI, you haven't failed if that's not happening.
Yeah.
Just so we're clear, because like we just said, everybody's journey is different. You might find that at 40. You might find that at 20. It just depends.
Yeah, it goes back to that sense of responsibility. You know, when you get a gig, it might be really good for you, but it might be bad for your community, right? So there's that balance again, yeah. Oh, and just one other story about grants. Having sat on juries, don't wait for the grant to start doing the thing. Yeah, so see if you can, you're going to be more successful in getting a grant if you're already doing the things that you're applying to get funding to do. Next question.
Just quickly, I just want to say also, your responsibility as an artist is the people's money. You just remember that. The people of Canada are actually paying for your project, so you want to be the best artist you possibly can be, so you're representing the people's money. Because sitting on juries, it's really interesting. Some people have big names, and they're like, put nothing into their grant, and you're like, they just expect the cash. Wow. Interesting. So it's really important that you're showing your responsibility as an artist, that you care where this money is coming from, and you know that thousands, millions of people are actually paying in for you to do this one project.
So vote. A question in the back there.
Just simplicating for Josh, how do you keep yourself strong when you want to create like a company and you're looking for dancers, you know, and then you want to create that movement, but maybe you are not giving like exactly the idea of what you want, and you can get people, but then you can get 10, but at the end of the like 2-3 months after, you have 5 or 4. How do you keep them there and give them the idea of what you really, like, make them to get that idea or that the art that you want to do, I don't know.
I think you're asking, like, how do you build a company of dancers, and how do you, it's definitely not easy, because everyone, just like yourself or just like anybody else, is everyone's struggling to do what it is they do. They're going to be pulled by different opportunities that make them have to force to choose. Do I leave for Singapore and go take this contract, or do I stay and hopefully this next 605 project works? But I think what happens is that you start to kind of see the people who are really related to your work. And I think that most people in our room aren't just there for the paycheck. They're there because, you know, they have an affinity to the type of work that we do. And I think when you're first starting, you don't really know what that identity is or what that what is going to be the identity of the company. But as as time goes on and dancers will come and go, you start to kind of build what that identity is, and then I think people start to come to you and say, you know, I really relate to what it is that you're doing here, and I really want to be part of that, and I want to make my contribution to that because I think I have something to offer that identity. And so I think it's just something that builds over time, and you learn how to speak about your work, and you learn how to speak to the dancers about what it is you're trying to get, and you see what works, and you see what doesn't work. And I'm still figuring it out, I don't think anyone really figures it out, how to get exactly what you want from the dancers every single time. I think it's something that you just hope will happen by the right combination of words, the right combination of material and structures that you've built, that the right thing will come out that you like. It's probably not going to be what you thought it was going to be, but it's going to be something that you like. And we're just so thankful to have dancers who are all kind of backing that same idea. They're all just in the same sort of curiosity and pursuit that we are. So I would say, find the people who are curious. Find the people who are really interested in searching with you, not who are wanting to follow you no matter what. It's not about a leader and follower. It's about people who are just as curious, who are just as into the investigation as you are.
Any other group? Yeah.
It kind of going off of something that Heather said about this, the stubbornness. I'm wondering if you can speak to that a little bit more. Like, when is it not appropriate? But is there a time when it's better to stick with your stubbornness and your vision of what you want to be doing in your career? Versus like taking opportunities that are coming to you and that may be coming up that may not exactly fit with the vision that you had, but in not taking them you might be like selling yourself short?
That's a really awesome question. Yeah, I'll also quick answer. I think the difference between your ego and your soul, you know what I mean? And I think the idea of what you think you should become as a dancer, like I should be dancing for NDT. Well, that's great, but if I'm not looking at, you know, truly where I fit, and that doesn't mean downgrade, this is a fine line, right? I don't ever want to think, like anyone to think that they have to downgrade themselves. It's not that, it's about really just finding where your soul wants to be, and like Josh just said, like I'm so curious in 605's work, so therefore I want to immerse myself in that. That's where I'd love to be. But I think it's the idea of like this is where I should be. That's ego, versus like I love dance and I want to explore as many avenues as possible to find the thread that is the one for me during that period of time. You might, through your 20s, just love a certain type of dance, and then in your 30s, you're like, I'm so over it, let's move on. 40s, you're like, I'm over that, you know? So that's what, I mean, I've struggled a lot with my ego, I'm not gonna lie. I'm very competitive, and that's what my piece is about, because it has ruled me, it's been very confusing, it can be. So I think it's really important mental health to really understand how you work within this world, yeah.
I think it's something that you are always kind of working on and thinking about. I was really stubborn as well to become an agent and say that I'm not a performer anymore. I was like, I'm not gonna say I'm not a performer anymore, because as performers we're trained, you do it until you can't. And I didn't have injuries and I was still getting job offers and I was like, oh, then I should keep doing this. But it was because I had just been trained to think that. Like, I need to keep doing this until I can. And I realized that I had said no to some other opportunities because of that stubbornness. And now I'm realizing how happy I am in this position now, and it doesn't mean that I have to say no more to that ever again. But yeah, I think it's just something you're always working on, and it's okay to not be sure, and it's okay to, I think it's good to take opportunities even though you don't think it's your perfect opportunity. It's not a sacrifice, it's not a downgrade, it's just being out there and trying things, and I think that's okay too, to still be working on it.
I think this also comes to, how do you define success, right? You're going into an industry that is not known for being especially like lucrative. You are not a doctor, you are not a lawyer. And myself, coming from like a very traditional Chinese background, you are Chinese, you should be in a profession, and ballet is not the kind of profession we would like you to be in. And it's how do you, again, stay true to yourself on how do you feel when you do something? How do you feel when you're dancing? Like, yes, you could go and study something else, but are you happy there? Are you truly giving back to the world in the way you have gifts? And if that's not what you're doing, then you're doing the wrong thing. And it's really knowing that, as Heather said, like, that may change. You might really love, I loved ballet for a couple of years, and then I was like, no, I want to be a professional piano. So I studied piano, and I was like, no, still love ballet. And it's being true to who you are, and also being financially responsible. Mm-hmm. Like, when you get your first gig, it's not like, woo, I'm getting paid. Like, okay, how am I going to do this? It's like, sit down with someone from the DTRC, talk to your parents. Like, how do you set up your finances in a way that you can pay your rent, you have groceries, and you still can have a little bit of fun? And what other grants or what other things that you can do to keep enriching yourself that may not necessarily still be just in dance, whether it's graphic design, whether it's Pilates, whether it's how to learn how to write grants. Like, all those other things will always bring something back to you, whether or not you see the return immediately.
So we need to wrap up because it's going to be lunch. But we're going to be around. Are you guys going to stay for that? Yeah, we're all going to be around to do more one-on-one or group conversations. So keep the questions coming. I have so much I want to say about everything that was just said, especially. I feel like we were just really starting to get back to that idea of like how to create values for your career. So yeah, looking forward to talking with all of you.
I want to thank Deanna and all of the panelists for joining us here today. They all came out because they really relate to where you are now, and it is really kind of you to take the time out to pay it forward and share all of the hard-earned wisdom, and thank you so much for that. And like Deanna said, they will be sticking around. I have a ton of announcements before we break to lunch because there's all this stuff. Lunchtime is go time. There's lots of things going to happen. Before I get into too much of that, I just want to ask artists who have shows coming up to do a really super quick plug before they go grab their lunches. So Deanna, do you have anything to announce that a project that you're working on? Later, but Deanna will be part of the information fair, representing two different major organizations, and now you've already gotten to know her, so FYI, she will be representing CADA West and CDA, and we'll talk more about that shortly. And then, you're good? Okay, but FYI, we do have a wonderful door prize, big door prize draw at the end of the day. There's a survey and a passport sheet in your kit here. They're both yellow. So pull this out, and you'll just see the yellow bits. Those are things that you want to have filled out by the end of the day, and you'll submit them together in order to be eligible for the big prize draw at the end. And we've got several awesome shows, including one with Euro Collective and Heather Laura Gray, and some others from New Works and Dance House, this really amazing contemporary hip-hop Brazilian kind of show, which you can check it out. And then Josh is also going to be touring and performing with the Vancouver International Dance Festival soon, yes?
Yes, that's true.
Allow me to pass this to you. I would love to share that news.
It's just the Vancouver International Dance Festival at the Roundhouse Theater, which is just down there, March 17th to 19th.
Speaking of Google It, that's another thing to look in the kits. We've listed all of our presenters. You can check out their bios in the program notes. There's also a little bit of a sheet there that has websites for all the different endeavors that our presenters are doing. So really, you have all kinds of stuff to follow up on and research afterwards, and you know, to kind of prep before you get brave and talk to these really lovely, friendly people who are here to connect with you over lunch. One of the questions I get a lot from emerging dance artists who come see me at my office that I might suggest as another thing that you could ask these guys about is CVs and auditions. And because what's really exciting, I think, is we have reps from different disciplines here, and all of you might be performing and auditioning and applying for things and grants and all that in more than one discipline perhaps, or maybe you're just really interested in how do I present myself? What kind of style and format and things should I emphasize in my CV? What kind of things do you notice in terms of audition prep? That might be an interesting question in addition to whatever you have burrowing in your mind but you were too shy to put up your hand just now. So please do be brave and connect with these folks because they're really here for that and happy to do that. And we'll also have a whole bunch of resource organizations who will be loading in and here to meet with you. And you've already heard about some of them. And you can tell that just knowing about them before you take that big leap, it's like putting this big safety net underneath you so that you know that when needs come up, there's people you can ask. You can get more information. There is support out there for you so that you can continue that momentum. And I want to thank you guys, go get some lunch before we do, because they're going to be so busy talking to you that they might not get a chance to eat otherwise. So I'm just going to tell you a little bit about the Dancer Transition Resource Center very briefly because I might be running about and in case you don't get to know it. So the Dancer Transition Resource Center is a resource center for transition into, within, and from a professional performance career in dance. Okay, and it's a complicated thing to sum up in a short little while. I'll just say that I run the BC office and we're a resource center for you guys, so you can connect with me via email. I'll put out some business cards, and it's me. It's the friendly face on the other side. We also are a national organization, so we have offices and reps across the country. If you go off to Montreal, we have a really well-connected, lovely, resourceful, and knowledgeable person there that you can talk to as well. We have a Toronto office and reps all across the country. And you don't have to be a DTRC member to come talk to us. I think another thing that is helpful for dancers is that if you're dealing with something and you feel a little bit shy about sharing it, know that if you're coming to me, it's confidential. So we can talk about what you're going through. And if I know of a resource within my organization or amongst our circle of friends, that might be a way to be able to connect you with some support. So don't hesitate, okay? As for members, there's a few examples that were mentioned here. Membership is open to folks who are pursuing dance professionally and have some paid experience on their resume. Ask me if you have questions about that. And it comes along with some benefits. And there's eligibility requirements at different stages. I really encourage you to find out about that as soon as possible, because then you know what fits you when. And we have some larger grant opportunities where you need to have a certain number of years of membership with the DTRC in order to be eligible. So don't assume that DTRC is all about, I'm done with dance and now I'm going to go talk to Zaina. You know, you want to talk to me as soon as possible and then I can sit down with you and go through all the resources properly together. Some of the examples that were given, new members can inquire with me about counseling resources, and we have five types of counseling on our roster, and DTRC membership can make that accessible for you. There's also grant opportunities like the skills grant that can be eligible to a new member, and that there's some examples that you heard of how that might be useful. That could be a part-time thing that helps you propel your current career, right? There are the larger grants for retraining, and that can be a parallel or a secondary career when you're more of a mid-career or established artist. And priorities change over the course. We've heard this from the stories that from the different dancers, and there's so many different paths, and it's so tailored to you and your life at different stages. And you know, we've had dancers who've pursued parallel careers and things like Pilates and yoga and nutrition. And then we've had people who have, in later in life, transitioned from dance performance into neuroscience, organic farming. I mean, I think it's great to realize the capacities that you're building up as a dancer, all the qualities that are transferable, but it also is very important to get some support so that you can reinvent yourself in alignment with your dance career or in some other capacity that complements it. If that makes sense to you guys, yeah? You're kind of getting it from this too, right? So anyway, all that to say, come talk to me later and it'll be easier. We can talk about what's going on with you and we'll go from there. Let's open this up and I'll talk you through what's all in it. So you've got your schedule here, schedule outline. And you see we're going into lunch, and this is go time for your networking. And for the afternoon, we're going to be settling in for a more lecture-style format with chairs and presentations, because we want you to have some learning that and some takeaway insights. The afternoon is going to start out with income tax for freelance dance artists. And all of these are introductions. They're a chance for you to sort of go, okay, this is something I need to pay attention to, I can learn more about. And I think the mentors here have already kind of pointed out how important those financial insights are, and any way you can save money. Find out what's deductible when you're doing your dance career and paying for travel and costumes and things like that. It's good to know now, right? We also have Christina Bucci coming, who's a nutritionist and a dancer. So some of the issues about self-care, that's very important. And she's a great person to be able to help. And Howard Jang is new to our DTRC board for BC, and he's also a faculty member at SFU with SFU Contemporary Arts and is very involved in the arts community. He's worked as an administrator with Ballet BC and is on boards for all kinds of granting organizations. So he's a really great person to learn from and connect with. He's finishing our day. For lunch, we're going to start off with the getting your lunches. And while that's happening, we're bringing in tables, our lovely volunteers are setting them up all around, and there will be some different resource organizations setting up their materials. And it's your chance to meet them. See this thing here? They will have stamps, and you can get your passport stamped for every resource organization that you meet. And make sure to write your name on everything, okay? And there's also an activity sheet here, Connect and Reflect. That's for your own reference. So, new connections, a piece of advice they had to share. How might you collaborate in the future? Something inspiring about this individual. And you can write their name and contact down. So that's just for you. And over here, which speaker or session was the most inspiring? Why? How have your personal goals been shaped or refreshed? What have you learned today? These are some reflections you can note for yourself, okay? This survey and this yellow passport, those yellow things are the things you want to submit at the end of the day. So start looking through them and filling it out. And this is the program notes with all the bios, so you can cheat sheet. And we've also got a list of some of the individuals who are here with their links and everything. So I think that's it. There you go. That's all the different resource organizations, okay? In case you're like, what was that? And on the other side, we have some of our panelists and the different resources that they're affiliated with, different companies and such, okay? So this is another resource right here. If you've pre-registered, you have a name badge. And it says what kind of role you have and what school you're from. And also, if you've got a lunch order, it'll say vegetarian or regular. We're gonna have a vegetarian section and a regular section. You can just line up and grab it. You won't have too much time to eat because you'll be talking to one another. And your other assignment for today is to connect with somebody you don't know in the room. So, and please do, if you're the one artist who's representing your discipline, then know that that's actually a gem. You know, we met a Bhanga artist, and wasn't that exciting to connect with somebody who's of a different style? So yeah, and please be careful about the food again because of the dance studio space. We'll have dancers all rolling on the floor after us, and we all know what that's like. So enjoy. I'm gonna invite you to get your lunch, and then after lunch, we're going to set up chairs, and we'll